free world in India is what we'll be taking up. 15-17 days is what we take to complete it. There can be some extension, though we are planning to take the classes as 2 hours each day. Some of the topics ask us to slightly extend the classes beyond, so I'll be extending it as and how it will be required. But do remember one thing, this is that part of geography which has got, if I take last year question paper, let me take that, I'm taking prelims question paper to begin with. We encountered a question which was asking us to, among the following, which island is nearest to Great Nicobar? You know, such type of questions are the questions which I call throwaway marks. These are the questions which do not take efforts for us to remember, is basically because we train ourselves to be aware of location. Is physical geography only about location that I need to be? Another simple question clicking in my mind right now. Three statements given to us. Himalayas extends in 5 states. Western Ghat extends in 5 states. Pulikat Lake is only in 2 states. Which of these statements are correct? Now such type of questions are the questions that should never go out of our hands. Reason being, these are the questions which are factual, easy enough for us to handle. But then examiner today has asked Pulikat Lake, tomorrow examiner can ask any other lake. How will I guarantee that examiner is going to ask what I have learned? It is basically that orientation which we give ourselves. It is not just about location. Such type of questions are very simple questions based on location, a particular relief feature and its location. But there are other type of questions also which can be taken up, because physical geography is also about mechanism. Physical geography, very common example. Are we aware of that Aravallis and Himalayas both qualifies to be fold mountains of India? Both of them are fold mountains, but what makes them different? One, the differences of location. If I go 1:1, Aravallis makes the location as Rajasthan. It's not only in Rajasthan, it is Delhi to Gujarat, including Rajasthan, sample case. So one is location, where I'm saying Aravalli is located in Rajasthan, and when I talk about Himalayas, from Jammu and Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh. So one point difference is location. Another point difference that gives us the logic of mechanism. Himalayas are young fold mountains. Aravallis are old fold mountains. Vindhyans and Satpuras like Aravallis are old, but they are block mountains. So there is mechanism involved for us to understand. Last 2 years we have not encountered any technical question to it. But if you see the question paper, because physical geography have always been part and parcel of our general studies paper, even prior to the modification with CSAT introduced. So if I ask you to take the questions that goes 4 or 5 years back, pet topic from where we have encountered questions from this particular is earthquake. And it is not just in regards to the prelims questions only, it is also main question. Like in 2016 May, we encountered a question which was asking us to write about, you know, why the western flowing rivers of India do not make delta. You know, such type of questions are very elementary. They do ask us to be aware of one location, two, aware of the names of the rivers or relief, and three, aware of the mechanism involved. First and foremost, I should have in my information list which are the west flowing rivers of India. And then comes the second thing, why they don't form delta. And if they don't form delta, what exactly delta stands for. So there comes mechanism. It's a bulky topic. It's technical topic which asks us to learn some of the important things. List making, I don't believe it. Making list is very easy task, but list do not help in the type of questions that we are experiencing, even if it is objective paper for our prelims examination. So what will be our approach? How will we approaching this particular head altogether? I take support of 6th class NCERT. 6th class NCERT says R, environment. Can you define environment? Environment is, what is environment? You're not feeling like speaking, or you don't actually know that what is it? Surrounding. My surrounding is my environment, and environment is divided into 4 parts. Name them. lithosphere, hydrosphere, atmosphere, and biosphere. Let us take it back. This particular part of our syllabus will not ask us to get into biosphere. Biosphere falls into which part of our syllabus? Environment, ecology, biodiversity and climate change. So biosphere, vegetation, wildlife, soil, etc. will not be our domain. So my environment, my surrounding, divided into four parts. Lithosphere, atmosphere and hydrosphere is in our domain. And then there is this scale that comes into account. We have to learn all these three realms out of four realms of our environment at two scales. Which are the two scales? Global and Indian. Maximum question in last few years have been in Indian context. But then it will be wrong, it will be incomplete for us not to approach it in the global perspective. So we'll be taking it in both these scales. Global scale, I'm on map of world. Indian scale, I'm enlarging. Enlarging what sense? One example again. Himalayas are considered to be mightiest young fold mountain. Himalayas are considered to be mightiest young fold mountain that has got east-west extension. What is the shape of our planet? It's a geoid. It's like an orange. It's a geoid. And when I open up the geoid, I see it as map. When I open up the geoid, I see it as map. And when I see it as map, to my north, I have Arctic Ocean, and to south, it is Antarctica. So because we are habitual of noticing map like this, it is like we believe it to be up and down, which it is not. Geoid, when it's opened as map, it gives us two horizontal dimensions. One, north and south. Getting it? When I'm traveling from Australia to Russia, I hope all of us can mentally travel. When I'm traveling from Australia to Russia, I'm traveling from Australia to Russia. I'm traveling in which dimension? Horizontal. I'm not going vertical. I'm going horizontal. I'm traveling from south to north. So dimension one, horizontal. It is called latitudinal. And if I'm traveling from India to United States of America, I'm not taking Pacific route. I'm going via Europe. So I'm traveling from India to United States of America. Which dimension I'm traveling? Again, horizontal. I'm traveling from east to west. So which are the two dimensions that we take on in account of our geoid opened up as map? It is two horizontal dimensions. One is north-south. We call it latitudinal. And one is east-west. We call it longitudinal. So both of them are horizontal dimensions. So when I take the account of lithosphere, hydrosphere, I'm taking them into horizontal perspective largely. India is latitudinally, NCRT information I'm giving you. India is latitudinally 8 degrees to 37 degrees north. Which hemisphere we are in? Northern hemisphere. So India, which is latitudinally 8 to 37 degrees north, is the example one, latitude, north-south extension. It is right there in Northern Hemisphere. And if India is from 67 approximate to 97 approximate, it is giving us the Eastern Hemisphere extension. Which dimension of India we are talking about? Both of them are horizontal. Latitudinal and longitudinal. I hope you are understanding. Is India having third dimensional extension? As mountains, Himalayas, this comes up. I hope you are understanding. Russia is not up India. Russia is north of India. What is up? Atmosphere. And what is down? Australia is not down India. Australia is south of India. What is down? Interiors of the earth. So be very clear with these dimensions because we are very habitual to. Let us now go down south to Australia. No, down means we are getting somewhere inside. Inside the planet earth. So when we learn lithosphere, what exactly are the dimensions that we be covered. Lithosphere gives us the possibility to cover all the three dimensions, latitudinal, longitudinal, as well as height. So lithosphere is land sphere. Is it only land? I'll explain it when I start with the details. Lithosphere is land. So I take land and I ask you to view on this outline map of world. I don't have any relief feature. It's blank Africa, it's blank South America. If I ask you to take this land feature, how many continents? Seven continents are there on the surface of Earth. We largely study six because Antarctica is uninhabited continent. We largely don't touch it. Wherever there is compulsion, we do give ourselves information about it. Is it so that the continents as North America, South America or Asia are absolute featureless lowland? They are not. They are comprised of big set of relief features, and that is what we study in lithosphere. So what do we study in lithosphere? We study relief features. What are the attachments that comes up in relief feature if I continue with the elementary introductory part? Mountains, plateaus, plain. But are they sufficient or not? We'll see to it as we'll start with the details. Lithosphere is incomplete if it is written as land. And relief is incomplete if it is written as mountains, plateaus and plain. This is not complete, but we are just giving ourselves an overview of what we are supposed to cover in this particular module of our study. So first part of our environment, first part of our realm with which we will be concerned is lithosphere. Lithosphere will give us the study to relief features. What are they, where are they, and most importantly, when they developed. Planet Earth has got history of 4,000 million years. So since 4,000 million years till date, old and young examples I have taken. Himalayas are young fold mountains. Aravallis are old fold mountains, yes? And what is Indian plateau? It is ancient. Because it is much older than the formation of Aravalli. So if I have to trace the time of formation, ranging from some 4,000 million years till date, by default there will be time, location, mechanics. And that we have to learn at two levels. Level 1, global features. Level 2, Indian features. As I was referring, Himalayas are mightiest young fold mountain. I am learning young fold mountains on the map of world. I cannot ignore Himalayas. But once I take the study to the scale of India, from world I have changed it to India, Himalayas will not remain Himalayas only. It will get enlarged. And that enlargement will include what? Himalayas includes several parallel running ranges. I am naming only three right now. Himadri, Himachal and Shivalik. On the map of world, I don't count it as Himadri, Himachal and Shivalik. I simply say Himalayas. So if you try to take the association between the two scales with which you will be studying on, it is enlargement. Because when I talk about relief features on the map of world, Indian relief features are too dominating to be avoided, whether it is mountains or it is plateaus or it is plain. So they are the part and parcel of global feature, but they have got the enlargement. Indian plains divided as northern plains, coastal plains, so that enlargement will apply. So lithosphere will be the study of relief, where we'll talk about mechanism and we'll talk about relief features development. Which are the processes that develops relief features are endogenic and exogenic. This is technical. Endogenic and exogenic processes developing relief feature will be our first block of study. In this first block of study, our approach will be paper 1, that is the orientation going towards the geography of world, physical part, absolute world orientation, and then we'll enlarge it to India. So all the relief features, this term is incomplete, I'll make it complete when I'll reach hydrosphere. So let it remain land. So relief features, largely mountains, plateaus and plain in both the perspective, world and India. When I come to atmosphere, can you attempt the definition of atmosphere? second part of will, second part of environment, the divide of our environment, atmosphere, realm of air. Why do we study realm of air? Because we need to study weather mechanism. What is the elementary difference between weather and climate? Elementary difference between weather and climate. Day to day is weather, and aggregate of weather conditions for longer time and larger spaces, climate. India is a tropical monsoonal climate. Tropical stands for warmer, and monsoonal stands for precipitation confined, more than 70% of annual precipitation confined in 3 to 4 months of the year. If I take account of Indian monsoonal characteristics, I'm convinced, I don't have much doubt towards it. Almost all of our country experiences more than 70% of annual precipitation in 3 to 4 months of the year. But tropical gives me a point of doubt. If I say tropical, I say warmer condition, agreed warmer condition, but is it not that we are approaching early morning, late evening, we have started feeling winters are here. So is it not that when I say India is a tropical climate, I am totally ignoring that low sun season, that winter condition that we experience in the country, let it be few months of the year. Let it be majorly confined in extra peninsula, northern part of the country. Why are we ignoring it, and by ignoring it, how correct we are in defining Indian climate? So again, the same reminder comes in. Weather is day-to-day change, climate is aggregate. And it is nowhere wrong that India experiences warmer condition for maximum part of the year, for maximum length and breadth of the country. Winters are there, but they are not as dominating as is high sun season. Technical, high sun season, it is summers. So climate being aggregate of weather condition, climate definitely will ignore minor elements that goes with weather variations. In the study of atmosphere, realm of air, we definitely give ourselves the demarcation of atmosphere is comprised of what? It is comprised of gases, aerosols. Some of them have got active role to play when it comes to weather mechanics. We do talk about that, but our focus remains on mechanism, weather mechanism. Here our approach of the study will be, we'll take IMD's rhythmic season cycle that we experience in our country. Our year is divided into 4 seasons by Indian Meteorological Department. Which are these 4 seasons? It is dry winters, dry summers, advancing monsoon and retreating monsoon. Logic that we are trying to give ourselves is, why will not take the weather mechanism in global perspective? It is wrong for me to say we'll not be taking it, but why we are taking it as India focused? We are example, India is example of that country which experiences all the major weather mechanisms. When will we learning Indian weather sequence? We'll be learning every major weather mechanism barring one exception, that is called frontal mechanism. So let me write front also. Tropical cyclone, monsoonal mechanism, everything. Everything that you can think about weather and climate will get the possibility to learn in Indian season cycle. Which will not learn here is front. I'm just writing fronts. Minus fronts, and why will not have, why we don't develop front in our country, the time will start developing the understanding of weather mechanism, it will come spontaneous. Only frontal mechanism, I hope you are aware of the fact that cyclonic circulations technically are two. One, tropical cyclones. Last few days we have been, today also we have got new typhoon being experienced in the central Japan, and the evacuation work have started. If I ask you to go a fortnight back, we had devastating hurricanes in Caribbean islands and United States of America. So cyclone has become very popular kind of natural hazard. Cyclone, which is tropical cyclone, has got another counterpart called temperate cyclone. Temperate cyclone is related to frontal mechanism. So when I study atmosphere in context to our country, that is the scale of India, I'm learning every mechanism of weather and climate, because our country gives us the possibility to learn it. Only one will ask us to go to outside India. There is frontal mechanism, and which are the locations that experiences it gives us a complete coverage of the global climatic condition. So much so that after this is done, I'm not insisting on column one because it is with which we will start today. So let it remain incomplete as of now. The time will be completing atmospheric study, level two, bulkier and more trickier topic. You will be in the position of pinpointing what makes Brazilian climate, I'm on this map, what makes Brazilian climate different from Chinese. That clarity will develop. Let it be that our focus of the study will be India, because we will be giving ourselves all the learning of weather mechanism as it is applicable to our country. Whether it is high sun, low sun season, changing insulation, what role clouds play in terms of manipulating heat budget, everything. And the difficult parts also. What is Indian Ocean Dipole? I hope you have heard about it. El Nino, Southern Oscillation and its effect on Indian monsoon. So difficult things. Jet streams and its role in Indian monsoon. So Indian climate will give me the logic to understand everything about weather and climate minus front. That is how we'll be easing down our understanding, however not compromising our requirement of global level of study of climate also. Climate is slightly more trickier than the study of lithosphere. After dealing with these two blocks, we will be possibly done with all the difficult part. Only minimal references. If I say it is difficult, hydrospheric study, the only thing that is difficult is tides. And tides have been asked as pet question numerous times, both prelims and mains orientation. Hydrosphere, 71% of our surface is water. We are blue planet. Hydrosphere includes oceans. What is the difference between oceans and marginal water bodies? I'm giving you the starter, you will give me the answer. How many oceans?
Four.
We are stuck up with this question.
Five.
Southern Ocean is 5 years back. Southern Ocean was considered the extension of Pacific, Atlantic and Indian Ocean. Now it is not. South of 50 degrees south latitude is the ocean called Southern Ocean or Antarctic Ocean. So we have got 5 oceans together: Pacific, Atlantic, Indian, Southern and Arctic Ocean. I'm giving you startup now. We are talking about, we don't talk about Southern Ocean or Arctic Ocean is wrong, but our focus of study remains on the 3 largest oceans: Pacific, Atlantic and Indian. So I'm giving you examples, you will give me the definition. Pacific, Gulf of California, South China Sea, quite majorly covered in our newspapers nowadays. Port Boiler, geopolitical significance, question was asked in your general studies paper. South China Sea, Gulf of California are marginal water bodies of Pacific Ocean. Gulf of Mexico, Mediterranean Sea are marginal water bodies of Atlantic Ocean. Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal are marginal water bodies of Indian Ocean. Kindly attempt the definition of marginal water bodies. Come on.
Water bodies are not much connected with land.
Water bodies which are demarcated by land from the main ocean. Caspian Sea is an inland water. Arabian Sea is a marginal water. I hope you are understanding. And Indian Ocean is ocean. So if I have to use the term ocean, I'll say largest mass of water. Thereafter, our mindset says ocean should be largest, sea should be comparatively smaller, then should be gulf or bay. That is not logic. Sea, bay, gulf, bight, these are all used as terms, names associated. Dead Sea, all of you must have heard about, is such small that I cannot see it on the map of world. It is difficult for me to find it on map of West Asia also. And Bay of Bengal, too big for me to ignore it on map of world, is called Bay. So sea, bay, gulf is more used as adjective rather than showing anything about the size. Only term that goes absolute with size is ocean. Oceans are the largest masses of water. We have got five of them. Marginal extension is that part of ocean which is demarcated by land. One way or the other, it is connected to the main ocean. And if I am bounded by land on all the sides, then I cease to remain marginal water. I become inland water. And the largest inland water is Caspian Sea, visible on map of world easily. You all must be aware of Caspian Sea. Mind it, Black Sea is also marginal water. Because Black Sea, Crimea, Russian invasion and annexation, you must be aware of it. Black Sea is connected to Mediterranean Sea. And Mediterranean Sea is connected to Atlantic Ocean. So Black Sea becomes marginal water body of Atlantic Ocean. So marginal water bodies, oceans, remains our focal point when we talk about hydrosphere. Is hydrosphere only about oceans and their marginal extension? No. When I say water realm, I talk about oceans, marginal extension, running water, river. I talk about ice caps, Antarctica, Greenland. I talk about groundwater, everything. But hydrospheric study as realm of our environment remains confined to defined mechanisms as oceans and their marginal extension. And this is where we give ourselves the understanding that lithosphere, our first column, is not just land. Lithosphere is also, carefully see what I'm doing. This is my geoid. I'll be showing you projector images as we'll be moving on, so the things will be much more easier. The center interiors of the earth. That means from the surface, if I'm going to the center of the earth, I have somewhere entered 6,370 kilometers. The outermost layer, some 100 kilometers, I'm enlarging this part. I'm drawing it here. Carefully see and understand what I'm doing. From the surface up to 100 kilometers of depth. Got it? I've taken curvature. I've picked up a part of the curvature of our Earth's surface. Up to 100 kilometers. Till where I take the center of Earth? More than 6,000 kilometers. NCRT approximated it and says 6,400 kilometers. 100 kilometers. This is my shoreline. This is my mean sea level. This is my continental crust. This is my oceanic crust. Average depth of ocean floor is 4,000 meters from the mean sea level. Getting it? I'm shading it now. I have introduced you to lithosphere. What is lithosphere? Column 1, red, lithosphere. Lithosphere is outermost 100 kilometers of the Earth's surface, which is comprised of both continental crust and oceanic crust. Why oceanic crust is always shown like this? Continental elevated, oceanic layer. Because I have got 4,000 meters. Mean sea level, what is the average depth of ocean floor? 4,000 meters. So lithosphere is not only land. Lithosphere is also ocean bottom. So how many parts we divide lithosphere into? Two. So how many categories of lithospheric pieces will be having on the map of world today? I have got seven continental crust. Yes, all of us? And I have got five oceanic crust. Do we study only oceanic crust in hydrosphere? No. We do study it, like you must be aware of. Deepest point of planet Earth, Mariana Trench. Mariana Trench is a submarine feature. It's not on land, it is submarine, below the water. You must be aware of Mid-Atlantic Ridge. So relief is not on land, relief is also submarine. So we take a part of relief when we are learning land and we complete it when we come to hydrosphere. It's a factual enlargement because by that time we'll be aware of all technical methods. So first thing is this. Second thing, when I talk about oceans, I don't just talk about ridges and trenches. I have got many more movements that are related, like what makes ocean water, sea water, marginal water different from river water? Salinity. I have to learn salinity. Why Dead Sea is called dead? Because it is such heavily saline that it cannot support habitat. I hope you understand. Salinity pattern, very important and typical part of our syllabus that we need to learn. Very popular topic when it comes on to the hydrospheric study, Geyer circulation, closed oceanic current system, which is clockwise in northern hemisphere and counterclockwise in southern hemisphere. Gulf Stream, Peruvian current, randomly you are aware of the names. North Atlantic Drift. They have got an absolute repetitive. Two dimensions, horizontal, I talked about in the beginning of the class. Which are the two horizontal dimensions on the map of the latitudes and longitude. Yes, all of us, how many oceans on the map of world?
Five.
How many of them can be called latitudinal oceans? Come on, you can answer.
Three.
Name them. Pacific, Atlantic, Indian. Excellent. Because Southern Ocean and Arctic Ocean will have longitudinal extension. Yes, all of us? Latitudinally, I have got three oceans. Getting? Of these three oceans, we see repetitive nature of closed current system, which is counterclockwise southern hemisphere and clockwise in northern hemisphere. So oceanic current system. So apart from learning relief which we take from here and we complete there, because lithosphere is not only continental crust, what else we study in this block? Relief, I am rewriting, I have given you a glimpse of how relief gets repeated here. The other thing that we learn is physical properties. I have already told you it includes salinity, temperature, which will be repetition of what will be done by that time with our climate study, and then circulation. I am writing movements, ocean water movements. How many ocean water movements we need to learn? Two. One is current system, I have just given you a glimpse of it, and two is tides. I am writing mechanism also. Tides are bulge, tides are pulse that are developed on the water surface due to lunar and solar attraction. Remember always, geography is the study of, it's a terrestrial study. Solar system, terrestrial planet. We are a terrestrial planet. Beyond asteroid belt is Jovian planet. We are terrestrial constituent of our solar system. Geography is essentially the study of terrestrial, that is surface of earth and related feature. We are not concerned with celestial account. Some exceptions are there. When I have to learn tide, because tide has got commerciality attached to it. Commerciality one, tidal ports. Question was asked in examination. Twice daily, the water level recedes so much that you can walk onto the ocean floor and you can come back. Which location we are talking about? It has to be Khambat, because that is where we develop amphidromic system, tidal mechanics. So tide, because relates to absolute celestial factors, solar, lunar, position in reference to earth, we do talk a celestial touch in learning what is tidal mechanics. But is tide only about lunar and solar attraction and the resultant tide? It is not. That is the reason I have written mechanisms. If I can mobilize what is called commercially viable tidal seaport, if in the non-conventional energy sources I have got the potentiality and some of the countries have commercially mobilized it also, tidal energy, it has to do something with the human capacity. It has to do something with the dynamism that I can relate to our lives. And that is where we say tidal mechanism relates to movement. Tide by itself is not a movement. Tide is only a bulge. But why it is included into the category of movement is what we try to learn when we learn tide mechanics. because the lunar conditioning of tides gives us minimum tidal time gap of 12 hours and 26 minutes. And all of us will agree that if 12 hours and 26 minutes is minimum tidal time gap, then the commerciality that goes with the tidal ports becomes zero. My oceanic vessel cannot wait for 12 hours for the water to rise and then go and flow movement. Sounds convincing? And if there is a tidal ports worldwide, there is something more to tide. That is what we learned. That is the reason tide is included into water movements. While learning these, we do give ourselves the references of China's 9-9, United Nations Convention on Laws of Seas. A glimpse of it automatically comes up. Because in Indian context, I don't have anything beyond learning what is Indian Ocean Study and the details. So United Nations Convention on Laws of Seas, territorial water. Every NCERT map that you open, Indian map, whichever feature you are referring, big footnote is there. The first line, printed with the permission of Surveyor General of India. Second line, territorial water of India runs 12 nautical miles from appropriate baseline. So when we are learning physical geography, we should be aware of territorial water, how is different from inland water, and what is meant by appropriate baseline if I want to transfer hydrosphere in the Indian scale of strength. Otherwise, I can easily remain confined in the global perspective. It will give me the coverage of Indian context wide. If Indian landmass would not have been there, my marker is at equator. If Indian landmass would not have been there, Northern Indian Ocean would have been an open ocean. Indian Ocean is called half ocean of the world. Because can you notice north of where I have placed my marker? It is not ocean, it is marginal water bodies, Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal. And which land mass is demarcating it? Indian. I hope you are understanding. So Indian land mass is the reason that Indian Ocean is half ocean of the world. The ocean that doesn't have northern extension. Atlantic, Pacific all have it. And mind it, this has to do with Indian monsoons. Continentality of Northern Indian Ocean Basin. Everything comes up in the gradual steps. Topic is difficult because it is technical, but each and every level that we are covering, references that you'll be taking, I'll be giving you leaflets of the topics that is as and how we are covering. You have to keep an eye on the type of questions that have been asked because our orientation will be overlapping. We'll be taking both objective and subjective requirement of preparation. Because all of us will agree to it. Objective question paper gives us more dominating compulsion to study the things in details. Because we cannot resolve out. If my understanding is not clear, I cannot seek down my all information to the four choices given. I need to be much crystal clear to comprehend out among the four given choices which is most appropriate. Because largely we don't get absolute answer. Choices that are given to us are appropriate most. And instruction also reads, select the most appropriate answer. It is not always absolute answer. And that is the reason we are having several RTIs that are against UPSC nowadays. So if you try to take that, my clarity of the concept should be crystal clear. And if it is done, I can easily solve out objective. So I don't believe in segregating objective, subjective, because clarity of the concept is required in both. Focus of the question last few years have been in Indian domain. Our focus will be also majorly on Indian domain, but will not be ignorant about map of world. So we are formally taking the beginning with our study of lithosphere in the global perspective. Now this map which is there in front of you, and from tomorrow on, all of you will carry whichsoever school atlas you are possessing. No compulsion of following any standard school atlas that you need to purchase, any year print. Simply carry the school atlas that you are possessing. The map, wall map in front of you, which has got a typical color scheme, is called photochromatic map. Sample case. Why North America looks technicolor? Why it is not absolutely one color, as I can see on this particular map? North America is giving me three colors, and that is repetitive in rest of the continents also. It's brown, yellow, and green. Photochromatic is that map, physical map, where colors are used to denote Colors are conventional symbols. Orochromatic maps are for physical maps. When once we'll start taking our school atlas, all of us with a different print and different publisher. One political map, say North America is our sample case. One political map in one school atlas will show United States of America colored orange. Other will show it yellow. Third one will show it as green. Because for political map, use of colors in atlas is only to make we, the beginners, to understand, okay, this same color area means it is politically one unit. So in political map, use of color is as per the choice of publisher. But in physical map, the color is conventional symbols. And what does these symbols denote? Every school atlas shows it. I'm taking some here. Morai increase green sea level. Morai increase the height. My color changes from green to yellow to brown. That means green is standing for featureless lowland. Yellow is standing for comparatively elevated region. I can call it plateau. Yes? And then brown or purplish brown, because height can go on increasing, is for mountain. So is it that we are absolutely sure that all mountains will be more than 3000 meters in height and all plateaus will be somewhere between 200 to 3000 meters? No. So there is a difference that we need to understand, and that is what we are understanding. Are we aware of Tibetan plateau? Tibetan plateau is the plateau that is highest plateau of the world, and its height is 4900 meters from the mean sea level. If I say green is standing for plain, yellow largely stands for plateau, and brown stands for mountain, Tibetan plateau will be brown in color. Yes, no?
Yes.
Right here. Tibetan plateau will be brown in color. Getting it? And Aravallis, which is a mountain, Nilgiris, Annamalai, which are hills, are right here yellow in color. That means yellow brown is for height. It's not necessarily for a given relief feature. Getting it? I'm repeating again. How do you justify removing the other two columns? Wherever required, I'll ask you to write. If you'll insist, I'll dictate also. But I'm insisting that you are learning the things here, because many things has to be taken into our account. And with one part of our general studies syllabus, you cannot devote 3 months learning only geography. So we need to be rational enough in our coverage study. So careful. Featureless lowland. I commonly call it what? Plain. Take example. Gangetic plain. Color that you can see is
green.
Central, the Great Plains of United States of America and Canada. The color that you are noticing is brownish yellow. Getting it or not? What I am trying to prove? Are you aware of Aksaichin? Are you aware of Aksaichin? Aksaichin, northeastern Jammu and Kashmir in Chinese possession. That is also plain. So for me to qualify as plain, I should be featureless lowland. My location from mean sea level can be at 200 meters, can be at 4000 meters also. Getting it or not? Where is Gangetic Plain? What is Gangetic Plain? Featureless lowland. What is Great Plains of North America? Featureless lowland. But what is the difference between them? Gangetic Plain has elevation 200 meters from the mean sea level, and Great Plains of North America has got elevation more than 3000 meters from the mean sea level. So for me to qualify as plain, height is not the criteria. What is the criteria? That I should be gently rolling, featureless lowland. Getting it? This is plain. What is plateau? This is how we draw the plateau. Absolutely school level study we are giving answers. Now I am using the term upland. And with upland I want to draw a few more sketches. Upland 1, upland 2, and upland 3. I'll make it 4 eventually. All of them are upland because they are abruptly elevated from the surrounding. What is the difference that you are noticing in these three uplands in front of us? This is called table land. And why it is called table land, all of you will understand. This is called amount. This is called mountain. What is the difference between the three uplands drawn in front of us? Is it actually height? No, it is the shape. They all are elevated, unlike plain which are featureless lunar. Elevated, thus they are upland. Which dimension you are going? You are actually going up now. You are not going north and south. You are going up. They are upland. If upland has got absolute flat top, we call it? Or much commonly? And if it is conical, we call it mount or mountain or. Attend the difference. Attend the difference between mount, mountain and cordilleras. Mount. From Jammu and Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh. This much all of us can visualize. From Jammu and Kashmir to Arunachal Pradesh. The distance that you are traveling is some 2400 kilometers. For this 2400 kilometers, you have got average elevation of 6000 meters from the mean sea level. You have got uninterrupted mountain wall that is called Himadri. You will call it what? Mount or a mountain range? Mountain range. Of this 2400 kilometers, 6000 meters of elevation, uninterrupted mountain range called Himadri has got world's highest peak, Mount Everest. Stamped height is 8848 meters from the mean sea level. Geologically, Mount Everest is rising even now. Unstamped height proven by geologists is 8852 meters. Mount Everest. Where would you, which term you will apply? Mount, mountain, what? It's a mount. Getting it? And now understand. I'm running from north to south. This is Himadri, this is Himachal, this is Shivalik. Fit in the term? Fit in the term?
Cordilleras.
Parallel running mountain ranges are called cordillera. Single mountain range, mountain. A mount. What makes mount, mountain, cordilleras different from plateau? That they are conical. What makes them similar to plateau? That they are also upland. Getting it? Plateau is table land. I hope it is clear. Very elementary thing, but should be clear. Mind it, height is not the criteria. I, as Nilgiri, is a mountain. Actually, hill, we call it as hill. Nilgiri is a southern hill. It's hill. It is conical. I hope you are understanding. And Tibetan plateau, the highest plateau of the world, is